How's it, church family? Welcome to Sunday Online. It's so great to be with you this morning. My first time singing in about 6 months, so I'm really excited. I've got my wife here and a team behind me. We're going to worship together as a church, be it at your home, be it at your friend's home, be it in your bed, and let's stand, let's worship, let's sing together.
Your ways, we're singing our own.
Got something for us.
Ooh, that was a wonderful way to start a Sunday morning. Thank you, guys. You know, there's two reasons I can't see you this morning. One is that you're in your homes and I'm here, but the second is my glasses have steamed up and I can't see a thing anyway. So welcome. It's wonderful to have you here. Just a couple of things to fill you in on what's happening in the life of the church. We are still functioning, we are still going, and even though we're not in the building together, God is working in amazing ways. So don't ever think that the church has to rely on a building to survive. A few years ago, the elders went on a retreat, and God very clearly spoke to them about the fact that we as a church family need to be working on being transformed. And there are three ways that we are working on that. One is that God is asking us to be transformed individuals. And one of the ways that you can do that is spending time with God every day and getting to know Him better and deepening your relationship with Him. You should have received an email this week telling you, giving you great resources on how to do that. If you didn't receive the email, let us know at feedback@homeground.org.za. But that email went out on Friday. And then the second way He's challenging us to be transformed is as a church. And on the 20th of January, it's a Wednesday, we're going to be having our day of prayer and fasting. And we're excited for that. It is going to be different to last year, obviously. But we will be sending out guidelines of how to pray through the day, if you want to fast, how to fast, the different ways of fasting and why we fast. And then we will be having three Zoom prayer meetings during the course of the day. So that's the second way, as transformed individuals, transformed church. And the third way is transforming as a community. And we are so excited because this year we are doing a different intern program to one that we've ever done in the past. How it's different is, first of all, the interns are not coming to serve in a specific area of the church. They are coming to be trained up as leaders in any area, whether it's in the church or whether it's for industry later. Well, however, we are wanting to grow leaders. And we are partnering with an organization called Latitude, and we are so excited for this. So they will be also, for the first time, housed together in a home that has been generously lent to us for this year. And there are two ways that we as a church family can get involved in this. One of them is to think about how we can financially sponsor this program. It's an awesomely exciting program and one that we feel the country desperately needs right now. Good leaders are desperate in this time. And so think about how you can sponsor maybe an individual or the program as a whole. We have 6 interns starting in a few weeks' time. And the second way that we need help is the house is an awesome house, but it has nothing in it. And so if you have anything lying around in your home that you think would be able to help us, why don't you contact either us at feedback at homeground.org.za or Jacques directly at the same jacques@homeground.org.za. There is a list in the bulletin that went out on Friday, so go and find that bulletin either on our website or in the email that was sent out on Friday, and there's a list of what we need. But if you can help us to be continuously transforming as we are called to do, we're called not to be, what is the word, patterns of this world, not to conform to the patterns of this world, but to be transformed, that's what we are called to do. And then we are going to pray together now, just to thank God for the opportunity of meeting together. But we also want to thank him for the opportunities of being able to give back to him, whether in a big way or a small way, how God has blessed us. And we know some of you are going through very hard times right now, and we want to pray for you too. But remember, even at this time, we are able to give to God with our tithes and our offerings through technology, and we are very grateful for technology. So there are ways to do that with our Zapper code or our bank account details. If you don't know how to do that, please contact us. We'd love to guide you through that on how best to give at this time. But let's pray together. Father God, we thank you. We thank you that we are able to meet. We thank you, Father, that in the middle of what feels like very weird times with all that's happening around the world at the moment, you are still here. Even though we are not physically together, we are still together. We thank you, Lord, that your grace and your mercy that was so freely given to us and that we have accepted binds us together. It's the thing that just holds us together is you, Lord, in the middle of us, and we thank you for that. Thank you, Lord, that we can play a part in what you have called Homeground Church to be and to do. We thank you, Lord, that we can spend time with you being transformed as individuals, that as we learn the discipline of setting aside time on a daily basis to connect with you, we can only be transformed. And thank you that as a church, we can gather together virtually on the 20th of January to pray and bring not only home ground to you, but this community and this country and this world. And then, Father, we pray for the 6 interns that are starting up with this new program in a few weeks' time. We pray, Lord, that by the time they move into the house, there will be furniture. They'll have a bed to sleep on and food in a fridge and all the other things that they might possibly need, Lord. So we pray that you would point out things to us in our own homes that are things that we can share and give on to this. So as we continue to worship you, Lord, as we listen just now to what Jacques has to say to us, and the word that you've put on his heart, Lord, bless us, Lord. Thank you in your precious name. Amen.
Let's continue to sing. Worship you because you are worthy. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God, you're altogether lovely, altogether worthy. Altogether wonderful to me. Sing light, light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me
together wonderful to me. In the beginning, darkness covered the earth. And God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw that the light was good. The true light, which gives light to everyone, came into the world. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. It is a light for the lost, the searching and the seeking. A light for the darkest valley. A light to drive out fear, even in the shadow of death. When we believe in the light, we become children of the light. It shines in us, through us. If we walk in the light, if we let it shine before others, we become a city on a hill. The light of the world. When we let His word light our path, others will follow. We become a beacon of hope to a world in darkness. Our lives reflect the glory of His resurrection. He makes us a light for the nations, so His salvation may reach to the end of the earth. Let there be light. For at one time you were darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light.
Good morning, everybody, and thank you so much for joining us, and thank you so much for tuning in. Wherever you are, welcome, welcome, welcome. So we're in the second message of a series we've started called Foundations, and we've been looking at the book of John, chapter 1, and more specifically, John chapter 1 from verse 1 to 18, and those verses speak specifically about who Jesus is. And if you watched last week, you would remember that Richard spoke about the first verse, which says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." And Rich taught us that Jesus Himself is the Word and speaks on behalf of God. So we're going to be looking at John chapter 1 today, specifically verse 5 to 7. But before we get into that, I want to share a quick story with you. So a couple of months ago, I couldn't fall asleep. My family was all sleeping, and I thought to myself, am I going to go binge watch something on Netflix, or am I going to go pray? So I chose the spiritual option, and I went to go pray. So I went outside into my garden, stood on my deck, and I just started praying. I was under the stars. It was a beautiful night, and I remember thinking about church. I remember thinking about where the church is at today worldwide. I remember thinking about specific church congregations. I remember driving through my area. I live in Durban North. Remember driving through my area and looking at all these little churches, many of them completely closed down. Some of them had been bought up by businesses, and many of them were just not thriving. So that evening, as I was sitting under the stars, I was praying, and I remember feeling a feeling of frustration. I remember thinking of the early church. We read about the early church in the book of Acts, and what a powerful, transformative movement the early church was. And I remember feeling slightly frustrated just looking around in my area, seeing how many churches were not thriving or didn't actually look like that early church. And I started praying, and I asked God to sort of bring revival, and it was a really cool time of prayer. And then at some stage, I sort of felt in my spirit like God was saying to me, "What do you see?" And then I must be honest, there wasn't much to see. It was dark. I could see my deck. I could see a little pool of water, which I call my pool. It's actually just a small little jacuzzi. It wasn't much to see. And then I just forgot about it. And I kept praying, kept interceding. And then I heard for a second time, "What do you see?" And I looked around again. And I was like, "I see leaves. I see a tree, but I can barely make out." And then I once again thought it was just my mind playing tricks on me. Honestly, a third time I heard it, and I thought, maybe this is God. Maybe this isn't just my mind playing tricks on me. So I just decided to pause, and I looked around, and I was like, okay, cool. Lord, what do I see? The clearest thing I could see are the stars and the moon. It was a full moon that night, and I said, well, Lord, I see stars. Then I just started contemplating and looking at these stars, and I remember reading, at that stage, I read through the whole Gospel of John, and I remember reading things about light. So I thought, okay, cool, these stars in the sky, it looks like lights. And then I just started thinking about these stars. Some of them looked like they were shining bright, obviously because they were closer or they were bigger or whatever, but looked like it was shining bright, and then some of them it were dim. They weren't shining as brightly. Then I looked at the moon, this giant ball of light or reflector, but this giant ball of light, and it gave the most light that evening because it was a full moon. And then I felt like it represented the church for me, or not us, the church, congregation. It felt like it represented the institution. And as I saw these dimly lit stars, felt like I was looking at some of the little buildings in my area that had been bought up by businesses and weren't functioning or shining a light at all. And then I remember thinking, Lord, I wish that the church, every single church in the world could just shine like that bright star. So this bright star. Lord, just shine like that. And then I thought, no, Lord, imagine if every single church could just be like the moon. I mean, that's the biggest light I could see right now. Imagine if every church can just shine like the moon. And as I thought about this more and more and more, I remembered that the sun, bright shining star, when it comes up in the morning, it completely drives out all the darkness. And it felt to me in that moment like God was reminding me of a passage that I read in John chapter 1 from verse 5. And it says this: "The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe." So we heard last week that Rich said that Jesus is the Word. John said that Jesus is the Word. And today, what John is saying to us in verse 5 is that Jesus is also the light. And when this light shines, it will drown out all of the darkness, and the darkness will not overcome it. What I love about this passage is that Jesus actually confirms this truth in John chapter 8. John chapter 8, verse 12, Jesus is speaking, and he says, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but have the light of life." So John says Jesus is the light. Jesus says, "I am the light of the world, and you will never walk in darkness if you follow me." And if you look at this verse in chapter 8, you've got to consider chapter 7, because this verse in chapter 8 is almost irrelevant if you don't understand what happened in John chapter 7. So they were celebrating the Feast of Tabernacles. There was a bunch of beautiful things that happened in this feast. One of the things they did was they built these temporary huts or temporary homes or little tents. And this whole festival was a reminder of their time in the wilderness, that the 40 years they spent wandering through the wilderness. And if you remember that story, so Israel were just set free. They were slaves in Egypt. God just set them free. Then they were wandering in the wilderness for 40 years. But what God did was at night, he gave them a fire in the sky, which gave them light. Whenever this light would move, they would move with it. And by day, there would be a pillar of cloud. So God gave them shade and protected them and also guided them. So when this cloud moved, the whole of Israel would move with it. And during the Feast of the Tabernacles, they would erect these giant candelabras in the temple when the temple was still standing. And this temple was on a hill. So when these fires or these giant candles were lit at night, it represented that time in the wilderness. And it reminded them of what happened during the season. So now when Jesus says in John chapter 8, verse 12, "I am the light of the world." John chapter 1 says he is the true light. Everyone knows what he's talking about, because they just came out of the Feast of the Tabernacles. So Jesus is saying, you were celebrating, you were burning these lights, but in fact, I am that light, and I am the true light. Now, what does that actually mean? I remember growing up as a Christian, I'm going into church, and people would say, "Jesus is the light of the world." You step down into darkness, and we sang all these songs, and it was beautiful. Then one day, I thought, what does that actually mean? What is Jesus saying when he says, "I am the light of the world"? Does it mean he's physically a light walking around shining in the darkness? Wouldn't that be great in South Africa with all the power cuts? But
But we know it's not a physical light, eh? We know it has a spiritual meaning. So I want to look at some of those spiritual meanings today. I love the connection. I love the connection between natural light and Jesus being the light. So let me give you an example of this. So natural light is pure. It's extremely pure. It's so pure, in fact, that no impurity can defile it. It can pass through the most dangerous gases without being tainted. So natural light is extremely, extremely pure. And I think that's one of the reasons Jesus called himself the light, because he himself was extremely pure. In fact, he was perfect, Scripture says. In Matthew chapter 4, we read that the Holy Spirit led Jesus into the wilderness to be tempted, verse 1 says. So the Holy Spirit leads Jesus into the desert, into the wilderness. He was going to fast for 40 days and 40 nights. And Scripture says he went there to be tempted. Okay, we're speaking about Jesus being pure, Jesus being the light of the world. So here comes temptation. The light shines in this darkness, shines through this poisonous gas. And yet, not once did Jesus surrender to the temptation. So Jesus is the light of the world, and he's pure and holy. And then Scripture says he dwells in us. And I think it's because Jesus dwells in us that when the day I became a Christian, something changed in me. I started desiring different things. So let me give you an example. When I was still in high school, I worked at this place where you jump on trampolines and they shoot you into the air, like 8 meters in the air with an elastic band and a harness. But we were stationed at Ushaka Marine World. And I just got an over working for this place, so I resigned. And they got a new guy in my place, and some of my friends were still working then. And one day we just went to go visit them. So I connect with my old friends and I meet this new guy. And my friend tells me, dude, you won't believe this new guy. He says, this oak rocks up on day one, and he says, guys, all of you, this new guy says to my friends, guys, all of you are idiots. He says, I've been here for one day, and I've worked out how I can take at least half of the money coming into this place. And I remember thinking, we got paid like 150 rand a day, which wasn't a lot. And I remember thinking, this guy must be super tempted. I wonder if he'll actually follow through. And the weeks after that, these oaks literally, my friends and friends included, they started taking money from this business. Eventually it closed down because they didn't make any money. But I saw as these guys lined their pockets. And I remember thinking, it's so weird that I no longer desire to do this. I'm not saying I'm not getting tempted. I'm not saying I wouldn't have been tempted when I was in this space. I'm not saying I wouldn't have sinned in that space. What I'm saying is something changed inside of me when the light came and dwelt in me. And that's the same reason why you may feel that you want to be different. You might not be different yet, but your desire is to be more like Christ. And I believe it's because the light, Jesus, dwells in you. Another characteristic of light is that light is gentle. Light is so gentle, in fact, that it travels at 300 million meters a second. So that's quick. So 300 million meters a second, but its wavelets break so gently that it fails to shake the drop from a blade of grass. And I think that's why Jesus refers to himself as light, because he is gentle. There was this incident where just before Jesus was crucified, and Jesus and all of his disciples were in this garden. Judas, the betrayer, brought a whole group of people, and he was going to betray Jesus that night. So he steps up to Jesus, kisses him, which was the signal that this was the man who Judas led them to, who led the revolution. And Peter responds with aggression. He pulls out his sword and he cuts off the ear of the high priest. And I love Jesus' response here. He says to Peter, bud, put down your sword, because those who live by the sword will die by the sword. And then he picks up this high priest's ear and heals him, puts the ear back on his head and heals him. And then Jesus responds to Peter and he says, do you not know that at my call I can call up to 12 legions of angels if I wanted to? but because he is the light of the world. Light is gentle. Jesus chooses to display that same gentleness even just before he was betrayed, or even during his betrayal. This is an extremely powerful message for you and I. I remember growing up or becoming a Christian, the church I belonged to taught me that you better not make a mistake. Because if you become a Christian, you make a mistake and you sin, you can't go to heaven anymore. The end of your life is going to be this giant scale, and if you did enough good works, fantastic. But if your bad works, your sins outweighs the good works, unfortunately, you go to hell. And then there was this message that you better be perfect, because if you're not perfect, you will go to hell. And that's not the message of the gospel. The message of the gospel is all of your sins has been placed on Jesus. God, the creator of the universe, unleashed his wrath for your sin on the body of Jesus when he was crucified. We no longer have to have this picture of a God who's angry and aggressive and tries to find you and zap you at every corner, constantly trying to find where you sinned and send you to hell, and then you're going to go to heaven and then send you to hell. That's not the message of Jesus. The message of the gospel is this. Jesus is pure, so pure in fact that he was pure on our behalf and was crucified and punished so we don't have to be. And then he displays love and gentleness to you and I. Another characteristic of light is that light reveals. So the purpose of light is not to be seen. We don't turn on the light so we can look at the beautiful rays of the light. The purpose of light is not to be seen. It is the very mechanism by which all things are seen. I'm going to say that again. The purpose of light is not to be seen and enjoyed. The purpose of light, in fact, light is the very mechanism by which all things are seen. C.S. Lewis writes in a book called God in the Dock. He writes a meditation or a story. It's called Meditation in the Tool Shed. And he says he found himself in a dark shed. He says the light was shining outside, but it was dark inside the shed. And he says as he looked up, he could see a beam of light shining into the shed through a crack on the door. He says it lit up nothing else. He could see the beam of light and some of the dust particles floating in it. And that's all that he could see while he was standing in the darkness. Then he says at some stage he moved into the light and aligned his eye with the light and looked through the crack. And what he saw was thousands and thousands of kilometers away, the sun shining brightly. And he saw beautiful trees and leaves, but he was only able to see the beauty that the light provided once he himself stepped into the light. It's possible, very possible, to stand and look at the light and visually see the light beams. But it's only once you step into the light that we see the true beauty that the light wants to reveal. Light reveals. Light illuminates. There's this guy in the Bible called Saul. He was a religious fanatic. And he persecuted Christians wherever he could. So he would find them, he would capture them, send them to prison. And in Acts chapter 2, it actually says he persecuted them to death. So this guy was on a mission. He was on this road to a place called Damascus. And one day, scripture says in Acts chapter 9, on this road, all of a sudden, he was completely surrounded by light. Then he heard a voice saying, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" And then Saul responded, "Who are you, Lord?" And then Jesus says, "It is me, I am Jesus. Why do you persecute me?" Scripture says that in that moment, Saul was blinded, completely blinded. What I love about that moment is that Saul, before that moment, was blinded anyway. He was in this shed, looking at this beam of light, not understanding who or what it was, completely blinded. But then physically, when he was blinded, when the actual physical light was removed from him, it was in that moment that he was illuminated. 3 days later, scripture says one of Jesus' disciples, Jesus actually sent him to Saul went over to him, laid hands on him, and then he healed him. Scripture says it's something like scales fell off his eyes. Instantly, but scripture says he got up and he went to the temple and started preaching the message of Jesus. So what happened for Saul here was Jesus himself shone his light, revealed the truth about our eternal life and our spiritual state to Saul. It was completely transformed. In fact, he took on the name of Paul. Something interesting. Some scholars say that he might actually have owned both those names. Saul was his Jewish name, some scholars say, but Paul was his Roman name. He then took on this name of Paul because he was a Christian now. He was no longer persecuting believers as Saul. And this guy was completely transformed because Jesus revealed and illuminated who he was to him. Maybe Jesus has revealed himself to you and you've received Jesus as your Lord and Savior. I believe Jesus wants to continuously illuminate his will to you. I want to wrap this up. When John wrote this book, he wrote it with the intent, especially from verse 1 to verse 18, to show who Jesus was. We learned that he is the Word. He speaks on behalf of God. In fact, he is God and speaks as God. We also learned that he is the light of the world. So the question is, any preacher asks himself at the end of a message, what's the application? What's the application of this message? What do we actually do with the fact that Jesus is the light of the world? The truth is, when you learn something about someone, let me give you an example. My father here on earth, my dad, because I know him, because I know stuff about him, I know how he is, I know his character, I know how he responds, and because I know who he is, I respond in a certain way as well. Because Jesus is the Word and speaks to you, that means because we know this, we can respond to that message that God wants to speak to me through Jesus, which can change my life. If we know that Jesus is the light of the world, that means that Jesus wants to illuminate in my spirit the truth about who he is. If we know that Jesus is gentle, I know that he's not angry at me all the time. If I know that the light illuminates, I know that God will reveal himself to me. But let me give you an application anyway, because I believe there is an application. Jesus says, I am the light of the world, and the darkness will not overcome it. And then scripture says that Jesus dwells in us, which means the light is in us. And because the light is in us, Jesus says in Matthew 5, verse 16, in the same way, remember Jesus is the light, shining light, in the same way, let your light so shine before others, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Because Jesus is light, we have to let our lights shine. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for Scripture. Thank you for your Word. Thank you for the Bible. But thank you most of all, Lord, that Jesus, you are the Word of God and that you are God and that you speak to us. I pray for every single person listening to this message that you would illuminate your truth in their lives. Pray that you would reveal the truth about who you are to those who are far from you. Lord, and I pray that because you dwell in us, that you would help us. Let our light shine so that the world may glorify you because you shine through us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks so much, Jacques. As I was thinking about worship this week, I was thinking, how do we close a service? And one of the things my mom actually said to me was, I was lucky to be her son. And that got me thinking, why did she say that? I mean, she's a good mom. But it had to do with this idea that her mother had passed the light to her, and she had passed the light to me. And I'm currently passing the light to my small kids. And it's the blessing that gets passed down. And then I got listening to this song, and it's called The Blessing. So I'd like to make this a prayer for you and for your family and your children this week.
The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn. face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious.
You.
make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace.
And all God's people said, amen. Have a wonderful Sunday and a great week, and we'll see you next Sunday. God bless.
Coming back to the start, where